actually, the chair of this year's awards committee is right here in the audience. Stand up quickly and take a bow. Shane Burkhart, the associate director of the Center for Economic and Community Development here at Ball State, a graduate of our program in 1998. There are two categories for the plans, there are two categories recognized with awards by the IPA. One of them is for plans, and the other one is for projects. Projects are anything that is not a plan. The first presentation today is by a team representing the award winners for the plan. This is for the Jeffersonville zoning ordinance. And just a few things before they give their speech. What particularly impressed the awards committee about this project was that it was accessible to lay people. That says a lot for a zoning ordinance. It is, in its organization, they found it to be navigable, so that people who know, who need to find out things from it before they go into building and other sorts of projects, can find out what they need. And they found that it was appropriate, that it addressed the issues faced by the community. Presenting the project this afternoon are Jana Ecker, who is the planning director of the city of Jeffersonville. She's been in that position for 3 years, and she is a new mother of a son just 3 months ago. Her degrees are from the University of Toronto, planning, and a law degree from the University of Windsor. Is Brian Sinclair here? He's our resident Canadian. Jeff Berkman is the other presenter. He is with Ratio. He is a graduate of our program, Bachelor of Urban Planning and Development in 1996. So, take it away.
Jeffersonville, and have that input in order to have a better ordinance. And in the long run, Warren, this worked out really well for us, because not only did we have all the interests represented at the table and decided what it is we wanted to address, but now we had a document that we could go back to and say exactly why a certain rule was created based on public input. And this has helped us out a lot in terms of enforcement. When we decided to find out what the key issues were, we started the public involvement plan. We started off by forming a 16-member steering committee. That included the Planning Commission members, the Board of Zoning Appeals members, City Council members, and basically somebody from every different interest, environmentalists, preservationists, developers, builders, realtors, parks and recreation folks, everybody, including, as I mentioned to Jeff earlier, a lot of the chronic complainers that we had in our department, people that call up regularly and complain about certain things in their neighborhood. We actually brought them in, put them on the steering committee, and invited them to join us around the table and tell us what their input was. With Ratio's help, we conducted a visual preference survey. We did a slideshow. At one of our earlier kickoff meetings, we showed slides in all different areas, for instance, residential development. We showed five different slides with different looks, high density, low density, no landscaping, wider streets, narrower streets, that sort of thing, and asked people to rank their preference in terms of which ones they like better, which ones they didn't. And we tallied the results at the end and came up with basically what the community's viewpoints were on these issues. We had signage included in there, we had commercial development, residential development, roadway construction, landscaping issues, all of those things were addressed in there. And it was really helpful for the lay people that we had around the steering committee to actually see these. We weren't throwing the planning jargon at them and telling them our different theories. We were showing them pictures and saying, hey, do you like this one better? Do you like that one better? Do you want to see low ground signs or do pole signs or billboards not bother you? Try to find out what the community's values were in that sense. We also conducted key person interviews. We invited 10 people from different areas to come in and meet together. For instance, Monday we had an elected official day. And they had an hour to come in. We had 10 or however many elected officials there were come and sit around the table. All the people with similar interests and backgrounds tell us what they wanted to see in our ordinances. Again, we had the environmentalists, we had the infrastructure people, the utilities people, business owners in town, residents, that sort of thing, and they were all people with similar backgrounds, so we thought this would create an environment that would make it easier for them to discuss their issues. For instance, the small business owners, they wouldn't be afraid to speak up, you know, with the environmentalists present, that sort of thing. So we had them all around the table at the same time. We got a lot of valuable information from them as well. Also, we had a total of 15 public workshops and hearings. We sent 300 postcards out every time we had a public workshop. We sent random postcards out, so we didn't send them to anyone in particular, just to members of the public at large. And we got a lot of people out to each of our workshops. So we did surveys there, and we showed some more slides, and we gathered input, and we broke down into small groups and asked them questions about what they wanted to see in town. And at the end, we compiled all those results, and we came up with the key issues that we felt Jeffersonville was facing. And the number one issue that was identified was signage. And I've got a few slides here. I don't know if you can see that well. This is a typical picture of Jeffersonville's commercial corridor showing our signage. This is the type of picture that everybody on our steering committee clearly chose and said they did not like. That's our typical Highway 62 that runs right through the middle of town. If you count those signs, you probably count about 30 of them in one area. Billboards, pole signs, wall signs, temporary signs, you name it. So this was our biggest issue that the residents of Jeffersonville wanted to see us tackle. So one of the things we really focused on was beefing up our sign regulations. And again, we had the sign contractors at the meetings, we had the anti-sign people out, everybody. And we came up with a comprehensive sign ordinance that really changed things significantly for Jeffersonville. I think there's one other picture there, yeah, just another example of what it looks like now. What we've gone to now is basically we don't allow any pole signs, we don't allow any billboards. If anybody wants to come in and apply for a billboard or a pole sign, they have to apply for a variance. That's a pretty strong stand for Jeffersonville, especially when we had no sign boards before, but it's something that the citizens and the community really said that they want to improve the look of our city, and this was one of the ways in which they could do it. The second biggest issue dealt with the gateways to our community. We are located along the Interstate 65 from mile 0 to mile 4 after you cross the bridge from Louisville, Kentucky. And along that area, there's three gateways as you come off the interstate there, and also on the other side of town. This is an example example of our premier gateway to Jefferson. This is one of the four corners. That's what it looks like. It's an abandoned fireworks store. If you turn to the next slide, Jeff. This is showing two of the other corners. On the corner with the rocket, that's also an abandoned fireworks store. And on the other corner, we have a used car lot, which is banners and that sort of thing. For some reason, Indiana has less strict fireworks rules than Kentucky, so in our town, being that we're so close to Kentucky, we have fireworks stands that are banned in 3/4 of the year, and for 2 or 3 weeks in July, around the 4th of July, they decide to open up shop, set up tents and fireworks stands, and be named along the side of the road, and it's so profitable for them, they actually leave them abandoned all that time. And they're right at our entrance, because that's where they're seen, and that's where people from Kentucky can come and get off the expressway and buy fireworks. So this is obviously one of the areas that we really identified that we need to clean up our gateways. When people get off the expressway and enter our city, this is what they see. They don't see our downtown, they don't see our riverfront, they don't see our nice business and industrial parks. This is what they see. So we really had to fix that and tackle that. One of the ways that we did that for the gateway was to set up a commercial corridor overlay district. So we had special rules and regulations dealing with signage, maybe signage being tighter, landscaping may be tighter, and we also looked at the design of buildings and required certain looks, for instance, brick or different colors, different textures, different roof paints, that sort of thing. Adding in all kinds of extra rules for these areas. This is an example of one of the newer projects that we have in one of our other gateways, and you can see this one looks a lot different than the other ones. It has a nice attractive sign, landscaping, and a nice looking building. Well, it is a hotel. It's, you know, not exactly the most innovative building you'll ever see, but it's a whole lot better than what we had before. Now, this isn't exactly under our new rules, but it was in the transition process where we were trying to basically make people follow our new rules, even though they weren't quite enforced yet. So we had pretty good success in that. One of the other issues that we had was landscaping. And you can see this picture here. There's no landscaping whatsoever in this gas station. And I was pointing out earlier, see that hill that's concrete there between the road and the parking lot? It's hard to see where the road ends, parking lot begins. That was actually painted green at one point. So that's a lovely example of the landscaping rules that we had enforced for the last 10, 20, 30 years. So this is the type of thing we wanted to avoid. And again, this was one of the key things that people said time and time again. We want to see the visual appearance of the community enhanced, and one of the ways we do that is by increasing our landscaping rules. So we really did that as well. We went from about 2 lines in our ordinance dealing with landscape to about 15 or 20 pages dealing with it now. One of the other key issues that we had was encouraging downtown development. A lot of our downtown lots, which a lot of residential downtown, a lot of it had been rental, because the whole downtown for the most part had been zoned for multifamily residential, which allowed landlords to come in, take a big old historic home and make it into 4 or 5 apartments. You basically had to go downhill, and they didn't keep it up and sort of thing. So we changed the zoning for all of downtown and moved it back to single-family residential. They were vacant lots, or it hadn't been divided already. And what we did was we changed the development standards to allow people to build single-family homes there. We reduced the setback requirements. This picture here is a typical example of some of the infill housing that one of our local developers does. He takes a 35-foot lot and he puts one of these little houses on it, and we allow them a 5-foot setback on either side, and a smaller front yard, a smaller rear yard. We allow more lot coverage, and by doing this, we increase the density downtown. We allow the reuse of the smaller lots, where people don't have to apply for a variance anytime they wanted to develop on one of these 30 or 35-foot lots, because basically they didn't fall anywhere in our old zoning ordinance. So we actually created a new downtown district called Old City Residential for our downtown residential properties to make it easier for people to come in and develop single-family housing, which was single-family housing is what we had identified as a need for downtown, get more people back downtown again. These next slides are, this one and the next one are both examples of some other infill housing. These are actually what we call zero lot line houses. They actually come right up to the side. We created a planned unit development district that can be used anywhere and have zero side yard setbacks. Basically, it increases the density and reduces the front yards and back yards, but it still creates a really nice setting for people, and there's some common green space. And so that's some of the success that we've had in that area. Also, one of the other issues that we identified was the need to preserve one of our scenic corridors. We're actually on the Ohio River Scenic Byway. it runs through Jeffersonville. It runs along Riverside Drive in what we call Utica Pike, which is the road that this historic mansion is on. This slide doesn't show it too well, but there's this mansion actually sits back from the road probably about 200 feet or so. And all along that corridor, if you drive along there, you'll see that all of the homes are set really far back. There's a lot of big old trees and a lot of green space out front. And we wanted to make sure that developers didn't come in and try to develop up to the street, cut down all the trees, and that sort of thing. So we did institute a larger front setback rule in this corridor, and we also instituted some tree preservation rules to stop developers from cutting down the big old trees and encouraging them to develop around those trees. And then when we were writing and revising this ordinance, again, I said we had a lot of public input. Our steering committee actually reviewed our ordinance section by section. We read everything and we met each time for each section. So we had a section on the residential development standards, a meeting on commercial development standards, and so on. So we really had full community involvement all the way along. A lot of our public hearings and workshops were through this revision process, so you could get people's input and comment on that. Again, we had the Planning Commission, the Board of Zoning Appeals, the City Council involved in this as well, which really helped us out when it came time of pushing it through the Planning Commission and City Council. We didn't have that much trouble at all. Throughout the writing process, we did have a degree of focus on the need to create a document that the citizens of Jeffersonville would be able to read and understand and use. Not only was this a selfish, basically a selfish idea, but we did want to answer many questions. And we wanted something that they could use, they could take with them, go home, read it, and understand what they had to do. And I'm just going to talk a little bit more about what we did to create that. But we just kept hammering on it. We wanted an index. We wanted an easy way out. And what we've got is documents where if somebody lives in an old city residential district, for instance, we can give them a two-page spread, send it home with them. It tells them everything they need to know on those two pages. And again, I think this was really helpful getting it through City Council because they were very impressed just by the layout of the document itself. I'm not sure how much of that document each of the City Council members read, but it sure looked good in that, so I think that was helpful too. When it came time for implementation of this and for the enforcement of it after the fact, it's been really impressive to see how well people have responded to it, how many people are able to say, okay, I see where you're coming from. When we explained to them that we had 14 public hearings and how we went through the process and how we came up with those rules so that they can see that we weren't sitting up there in our offices making those rules up and forcing the citizens to abide by them. Most people know what kind of public participation we have. They know where they came from. When we explain that to them, they realize, okay, this is what our community wants, and they're a little more willing to work with us. So I'm going to turn it over to Jeff now, and he's going to talk to you a little bit more about the
A lot of people, the first question we often get asked about as a firm is what does an architecture firm know about zoning ordinances? And that's a good question. The purpose that we brought to this project, and in general, I think we bring to a lot of projects, is that we looked at this Jeffersonville zoning ordinance as a design exercise. And that means it carried over from public participation process that Gina talked about, that carried over into the design standards that were developed as we looked to design different zones throughout the city. And it also carried over into the formula document. As Gina said, there are very clear goals that the city had regarding the use of the document, the use of friendliness of the document, the ownership that the community might take in the document. And that is a good fit with our approach to the zoning ordinance as a design exercise. And what I'm going to focus on is really how that translated into the format, layout, and the user friendliness of the document. Some of the things the document is doing just to assist the layperson using it. There was an alphabetized index, which was as simple as that sounds. You find a lot of zoning ordinances don't have it. So if you want to know about landscaping, you can look in the back and it tells you every page where landscaping is mentioned. And a lot of ordinances just didn't have that for whatever reason. It doesn't have it included here. It has a use matrix, which is something that, again, a pretty common sense sort of thing, but a lot of ordinances just don't have that. Where you look down one one column is a list of uses, repairs, single family home, whatever. And there's a use of list of districts, which things are permitted that you can cross-reference. Again, pretty common sense sort of thing. Not a lot of ordinances use those, however, that's something that we actually got included here. And a couple of things, but the main focus of the document format was a series of what we call our two-page layouts, if you will. This is the first page example of that. Janet showed you some slides earlier for the residential district. Oops. And this is an example of how that district would appear in print to people that were interested in. What you've got here, pretty much got for every zoning district, there's two pages that contain all the basic information you need to know about that district. In this case, it's the first list of pages for the old city zoning district. You've got some more paragraphs to talk about the intent of that district. And this is what's the purpose of it. What's the city trying to accomplish with that district? You've got a list of permitted uses. You've got a list of special exception uses, which are uses that are generally acceptable, which you need to get special approval to have all those uses in that area. So the first page is a two-page layout. In all cases, for all districts, tells you what the intent is, permitted uses are, and the special exception uses are. And the second page looks like this. So what you get is, if you're a Joe citizen and you come in and you want to know what the zoning of your property is all about, Janet or somebody else in our office can hand you these two pages and you essentially know all the basic information you need to know. The second page includes diagrams that help with definitions. This one here, for example, shows the various setbacks on the property. And what that means, so if somebody sees that text, front yard setback, what does that mean? Then you can look much about the distance from the road back to this corner of the property where you're not allowed to have benefits. So you get very, very simple drawings, hopefully very user-friendly drawings that they help with some of the definition of what some of the requirements are in the document. You've got a list here of all of these basic requirements are. Each of these things generally relate to what the little picture is above them, to how people relate the actual requirements in print with the how that translates on the property, which is something for my wife is an architect and she reminds me daily that I'm not very good at visualizing. Now I can read that in text and I have a difficult time translating that AKA into a property situation. But I know I'm happy with her, she can do that. But this is good to help people like me and the anarchists can't translate what that language is and how that works on the property. You must go a little drawing about how to get in some definitions. You must go a little box here that if you really want to know that some of these means beyond basic information, you can go in and this provides a reference to go to a single requirement in the ordinance that is applicable to that property. So the next step for you after you get these two pages, you develop a basic understanding of what that means for you. Landscaping standards. You want to know about what is a floodplain on the property and how does that affect me? Come back in and get any of the whatever part that applies to you. And that translates here into just pages here that look like this on the development standards for the property. And more details about, in this case, temporary signs. Which are high level details about landscape requirements, sign requirements, setback requirements, floodplain regulations, and those sorts of things. Here in this section, and each of these little titles is cross-referenced back to that two-page format. We've also got each district has code and color. So if I'm interested in the regulations for the R3, which was the old city zoning district, if I'm interested in all the regulations that apply to the old city zoning district, I'm going to go to that development statement section. I don't look for the little orange square. And that'll tell me exactly what the regulations are that apply to me. So it's very, the intent is to really help the average person navigate their way through zoning codes, which we can see in the cumbersome documents that we work with. And the last part of that was definitions. And I don't know how many of you have a lot of experience reading zoning ordinance definitions, but probably need a definition to understand the definition. That's just correct. So the key point this ordinance, that everything's the same kind of friendly, basic diagrams that we use to describe different districts, and you show up in the definition section. That was interesting in the building envelope in this case, and this whole picture of a house with setbacks around it, and that defines the building envelope district itself. So, basically, that's the intent. I'll just emphasize that the whole approach here, the unit was to assess its ordinance as a design exercise. And that we felt it had to extend the document itself to make sure that Jefferson could accomplish the goal that they wanted and to allow the average layperson to use that document. So, with that, we take questions or reach out
to private consultants and hired agent TV and November 1999, signed the contract. With this, I started off with public hearings. We created a core planning group, which consisted of one of the county commissioners, who was the commissioner representative to the planning commission. I should mention Port of County is an advisory planning commission. We just deal with the unincorporated area, and none of the cities and towns had any 2-mile territorial jurisdiction. We do have everything within the unincorporated area. So we started off with this procedure. HNT came with a SWAT exercise, strength, weakness, opportunity, and threat. So we did this with the 5 special interest groups that HNT wanted to interview with this. And I set this up with the staff. We had builders and developers coming in, the economic development, the agricultural community, cities and towns, and conservation. We had those 5 groups come in to hit the SWAT exercises, recognizing that it isn't within the plan what our 5 strengths are, top 5 strengths, top 5 weaknesses, they felt, top 5 opportunities, top 5 threats. It is very interesting now, since we finished this plan, to go back and actually look at that and see how these really fit in that layer. From there, we went in, and after doing the SWAT exercise, we also did mission statements with each one of those special interest groups. They took it to the public, and there they did an exercise with the public trying to find out what an adversarial type positions. Do you believe in property rights? Do you believe in protecting the farm? And trying to get the poll from the public there. We had this meeting in the south part of the county in the commissioner's district. We had it in the center commissioner district and the north commissioner district. So we had a number of public hearings with HNT conducting the hearings, and the staff also participated in it. And we also did something else. Because one of the things going through this process, we were criticized about the fact of not getting out in the newspaper, not getting this out to the public. I know that the presentation you saw beforehand mentioned about mailing out flyers to people and telling them about it. We used the media network. And we took it on the road. I had what we call the road show. And this did not include agent TV. I had 2 meetings with agricultural groups. The Purdue Extension Service, the Farm Service Agency helped set those up. We had real good attendance with farmers coming into those. We also took it to all of the planning commissions. I wrote letters to all of the city and town planning commissions and said, hey, you know, this affects you. Our planning commissions are in the community. You know, we would like to come and present this and hear the comments from your planning commission. So we took it to all of the planning commissions that were interested in hearings. We do that 12 communities. And out of that, we did take the 9 communities in towns. During the month of September, I don't think I was ever home. That's when we got a lot of these meetings going around, trying to get it out. We figured, you know, we're going to get criticized at these meetings, saying that we're not getting it out to people, so we figured we're going to take it to people. I also had a meeting with League of Women Voters calling and saying, we've been reading this. What is this kind of plan? I says, tell you what, I'll make a presentation to you. So we did a lot of that. Land surveyors, licenses, surveyor and training with the state. And I know a number of land surveyors, this is a professional did come from and so I gave a presentation to the Land Surveyor Society. Did to an honor. This is the existing land use map that we have here for Port County. Yellow residential development, you can see I'm going to scatter it through here. The city of Valparaiso, up in the northern area. I'm going to go along here. This is State Road 2 coming through Port County, right through here. All right, this area here is predominantly agricultural. Up in here, obviously, with the cities and stuff, it's more urbanized. We are part of the Chicago metropolitan statistical area. And there's great transportation to Chicago. There's a number of people who've worked and lived in here. We have the South Shore train goes across, so we do have population here also in Valparaiso. But one of the things why we want to go about doing this was this static development we're seeing coming through in some of these areas. But out of the land use, 56% of Port County probably is in production as far as agricultural goes. But we are becoming a recognized town population projection. One of the things we want to do, I mean, we kept on hearing steering committee beforehand. One of the things we want to do is make sure that the steering committee, somebody felt that the public would get the impression that this is smoke filled room, run politicians sitting back making decisions on this, and people weren't going to have a say on this. The only decision we really made was on population. The current population for Ford County is about approximately 148,000 people. During this process, HMTV did a number of projections as far as the population went for the county. I think we had a final population we were looking at 220,000 people. The unincorporated area alone, to give you an idea of population currently, is about 68,000 or 67,000, which represents about 46% of the population within the county. One decision the Ford group made was this projection. It's based on a linear projection that HMTV presented to us based on our building permits. Past 5 years, Ford County has been writing 450 single-family residential unit permits a year. From that, we figured in this period, what we're going to have in a 20-year period of the 2020 plan, we're going to write 9,000 single-family residential units in this period. So, population projection, we have an incorporated area, was 91,300, and it's about 220,000 we're figuring for the full county. This is a mission statement, and it ended up being rather lengthy. The environmental group was wild trying to get a commission statement on them. I think this is long. It should seem long for the conservation department. One of the things here again we're going to talk about is talking about protecting property rights, but also trying to preserve open space, agricultural, and natural areas. I mean, you might say this is a conflict of property rights. Protecting those and also protecting open space. Well, yes, during the exercise of the public, and it was fairly split. They wanted 50% of the room to probably stand up and said, we want property rights here. 50% of the other, on the other side of the room would stand up and say, we want more preservation of farmland and natural open space. So it was quite a situation you can go through. All right, as far as the director goes, this is probably the number one thing I had from people come into my office asking me about what this future land use plan is. What is it going to do to my property? One of the biggest things we had to tell them, it's not zoning, it's a plan. The whole idea we want to do is guide location, future development, guide future character of the county. We had a lot of strip out development, strip out commercial, strip out residential. Even Builders Association supported our goals and objectives, where we said we want to eliminate this. What can we do to improve commercial development? We want to enhance our gateways and corridors coming in, US 30, somewhere US 20, US 12. So I think that is probably the biggest hurdle. It's trying to explain to people, we're not doing zoning. This is just a guide, it's a plan. It's not going to be adopted as an ordinance or as law, it's going to be a resolution. Environmental map. There shows you can say the Department of Natural Resources has a safe harbor. It's up here with the dunes, the National Lakeshore, Indiana Dunes National Lakeshore owns a lot of property up here. Plus, also down in some of these areas, this floodplain here. They have the Marin Rookery in this area. State and National Parks owns a lot of land right up in this township, Pine Township. Major land in that area, but there are a lot of significant features. This area right through here is pretty much a divide for our watersheds. North goes up to Lake Michigan, south comes down to the Pink River. One time this was proposed for National Wildlife Refuge, I think, since it did not get a very warm reception by the Indiana counties out here. I believe Packer bags have gone over towards Indiana, Illinois, excuse me, that section, which I thought it was a shame. I thought this was more of a future one for us, but I want to make that in front of the commission since it's something like a resolution. But the state also owns has a nature preserve in this area. Very large land holdings with very steep slopes in this area. And wooded property, so we have a number of significant features. Wetlands, salt creek, floodplains, which I'll take note of this map later when Cynthia goes through and starts showing the future land use as well. Pine Farm. Originally, this wasn't in the plan. But about halfway through, people started screaming St. Bruce's Pine Farm. So this was developed from the Soil and Conservation Services. Named the class one soils in this area, the best soils in the county. It's interesting, and here is the city of appraisals, the city of appraisals industrial development corridor that they want to develop their industry. Fort County Airport, which we want to use as a kind of economic development block, sits also in this area. So I lay out a plan for my business here. Some of the things that was interesting, I had two meetings with the agricultural community on this, and it's definitely a different group. I asked them how many do preservation farmland, everybody who remembers it, close to 40 people. And as I mentioned, KK's earlier studio had asked for these things, and the question after that was, yeah, I believe it, what's in it with me? To give you a little story, one of the groups I went to and I talked about, and as a matter of fact, a farmer was now in this area, I know him really well. And he said he came driving down the road one day, and he looked, and there was a bunch of lath out there. Staked down, orange root, surveyor's lath, thought it was a subdivision coming in. Oh my gosh. Went running home, he said, Mom, quick, pack bags, there's a subdivision coming in down the street. And he stopped and thought, this is the way. Hold, that's why I got a plan back there on that sand ridge in the time to see it's up. So, the farmers made it clear. The best comment I heard was, okay, yeah, this might be good soil, that might be late, it's pine farmland, pine soil, but within that parcel, not all of the soil is pine. And this particular farmer was talking about subdivision, and here something said, you know, I had that same root back there, I'm going to possibly develop a subdivision. So one of the things they were talking about was the ideal of some work with us. Sometimes you talk for something like that, we had a area that you feel is not prime for crop production, how can we work with you and make it into something possible residential development? So, okay, and that's something we have to take into consideration. This is utilities maps to give you an idea. Right here, this band going out here, there's a town over here over Lake County. So, this strip here, if you want to see how zoning can shape a county, this is a good example. We are getting good development into this area. A number of them, as you can tell by the sewer and the water that is already located in this area. This is with an area right through here that's zoned residential, R1, would allow this type of development coming back in 83, hoping to go forward. There are some nice developments out in this area. This being the 60s right there. But this gives you an idea. Keep in mind again the same map going on, especially when you see conservation zones coming up and utility services are in this area here. One of the things we had to do is the future land use map to break our conservation areas down into two areas. One is rural, one is urban. How do we deal with each one of those? Both urban conservation area and one of the utilities come in, which is mainly in this area right here. They're present, it would help us. Certainly, density that would be acceptable. One of the goals when I came in was trying to get agencies on the same page, including ours. And I guess this is kind of an example I want to give an employee of bike routes. One of the things I pointed out in my interview with the Planning Commission was our local NPO, Northwestern Indiana Regional Planning Commission. Sends out our federal dollars as far as highway construction is going on. They have their federal highway system, they go by with arterials and collectors. The Planning Commission had their own arterials and collectors. They were different. I just felt it was important, I told the Planning Commission when we everybody needs to be on the same page. When we get involved in planning, this is an example here. It's bike routes. It was developed. HNTV collected all this information. Red here was done by the Porter County Tourism Board, setting up bike routes. The yellow here is set up by NERPC, our MPO, as their 2020 regional bike route plan. And I just felt that it was important. We need to bring all organizations just together and get on the same page as far as planning goes. So that was one of the reasons why I wanted to do this. Well, there is, here again, the city of Porter is pretty much taking in most developed areas of them along the boundaries. But the stretch in here, this is what I was talking about, is what's the area that's zoned R1 back in 1983 and did foster and develop. We are seeing development going in and connecting in between the city of Valparaiso and Chesterton.
And that was one of the things we were talking about with the plan too, is trying to see how we can have development come through to keep these separated so each one can have their own identity. They did not blend in together. So we're trying to replace that with the plan too.
At this point, I'm going to turn this over. And Ed's, after she's finished meeting, if I can compliment him, just talking more red today as far as following through with the process.
Okay. Thanks, Mom. You know, I just hopefully that stay up there. I do actually have that a few times. We're going to shift gears just a little bit and talk about, you know, Bob talked about, first of all the maps that we created. And we generated this through using a GIS database system. Now, as Bob talked, public input was a key component of getting this plan adopted, reaching compromise with people. But the other component to it was using a GIS system. GIS standing for Geographic Information Systems. It's a series of databases that can collect information as well as display graphics. Graphics, which became the key to transmitting this vision to the people and helping them decide where they want to go. Well, once we've collected all the information, we wanted people to say, okay, if we continued on with the same type of development policies, what is the county going to look like in 20 years? This is what it's going to look like. We created what's called the status quo scenario. As you can see, the roads just continually strip out. Okay, you see, you see, you continue to have development around the cities in this big swath, but then you see down here, development begins to strip out all of the roads, meaning higher cost to service all of that development. Okay, that would be great. So, but one of the key components of this plan was to protect the character. Again, utilizing pictures, we showed them, you know, and have them buy into, this is the character that we want to protect. This open space, this rural feeling. And the county unanimously agreed, status quo development was not what they wanted. It's not protecting the character. It is costing the county extra money to service these people. So what are we going to do? So HNTV devised a system. We devised a three-tier system. A first one being an urban tier, which you see right around Valparaiso here. The second one being a suburban tier. And the third one being a rural tier. Instead of looking at specific land uses such as residential, commercial, industrial, we had to simplify it into these tier systems, showing where development can go. Obviously, the more concentrated development we wanted around the existing communities that had already developed. Moderate density development, we wanted it to occur in the swath where existing utilities were already there, as well as existing then this third tier, this rural tier, was left for less intense development, less intense residential uses, and farmland. So we created the future development patterns. And unfortunately, because of the modeling system we use, set it up in GIS, it takes a minute for the scenario to come up. But what it is we took our GIS system and used it to model different scenarios. And then, As you can see, it's much more dense. Now, the percent signs, which are supposed to be squares, actually represent single-family subdivisions that could occur out in the county. These would represent approximately subdivisions of 75 homes, whereas the smaller dots that you see up here represent two homes apiece. So under this modeling scenario, we were saying that the majority of the development would continue to occur in this urban tier and around the urban tier, and then a few subdivisions scattered throughout the rural tier. Okay, the future development scenario took that modified scenario and took it one step further. Again, using the smaller red dots as two homes per, or representing two homes, the other little, again, percent signs, which are supposed to be larger squares, represented 185 homes and subdivisions. Now, the purpose behind this, again, was to concentrate development into specific areas. As you see, there's no more stripping out of the roads, therefore, costing the county less to provide services. Now, the trade-off is, with this is that when you have larger subdivisions, then you have to have smaller lots, higher density. The issue that you come into then is sewer and water services. With smaller lots, you cannot have private wells or septic systems because of contamination. So then we have to look at, under this scenario, different methods to allow public sewer and water, whether it be through packaging plants or through other conservation design mechanisms, more wetlands to treat wastewater, things like that. So again, using pictures to show that agriculture is a way of life there, they want to protect and preserve that. And the ways that they can do that is through clustered subdivisions and large lot subdivisions, utilizing these techniques in rural areas to begin to first create and promote creativity and flexibility for developers to continue to encourage development, but at the same time to get at the main issue of protecting the character. So with all of that in mind, in utilizing the background data that Bob talked about, we created this land use scenario. Now I should say, this scenario went through four or five different reiterations before we finally came to this. But it was one that everyone could come to consensus on. What you see here is, you see this lighter green area as the rural agricultural development areas. Again, allowing some subdivisions in there and understanding that that needs to occur, but limiting how that's going to occur by utilizing open space and buffering through provisions, clustering techniques, so that way the character stays similar to what is going on already around this area. Then we have the, as Bob talked before, the conservation areas, which you see here and here, and then also down here. We divided this into two distinct areas, because initially we had a whole entire ring around Valparaiso. And of course, the builders thought that we were promoting some type of conspiracy theory by not allowing them to build around Valparaiso, because the conservation areas were just that, areas to promote conservation. So we developed the two tiers, the first conservation area being the areas that are centered around, like I said, Valparaiso, which will allow certain type of development, one to two dwelling units, but again, encouraging cluster type design. So you really begin to protect those environmental features, which were really small, right through here. Now, tier two for the conservation areas are located here and up in this area, where significant environmental features were, including wetlands. As you all know, you try and prohibit development to occur in wetlands. So one of the things that we looked at was implementing a 1-to-20, one home per 20-acre density. Now that not meaning that the lot had to be 20 acres big, but the density, for example, if you had 80 acres, you could put up to 4 homes on that lot, but they could be 1 acre apiece. So again, encouraging flexibility, but also promoting and protecting the sensitive environmental features that were there. We look at this orange area that you see right here is the urban fringe area. And again, these areas are situated around existing development, looking at much higher densities, 4 to 6 dwelling units per acre for single family units that have public sewer and water, and then 10 dwelling units per acre for multifamily. Now for Indiana, those standards are actually pretty high. For a metropolitan statistical area around Chicago, those are actually on the lower side. But again, it's the give and take. Being the northern part of the county, where we're going to have the higher type densities, and the lower part of the county, where we're going to conserve more of the rural character that's been established there. Now you'll see a couple of areas like these. These are key commercial and industrial areas, and the patched in areas need their existing. Again, we want to obviously promote some of that within the county, and they just need to occur in those areas. Finally, implementation. You know, once a plan is created, a vision is set, the most important part of the comprehensive plan is the implementation section. I mean, that's where the plan comes off the shelf and becomes a living document that's used every day to help guide your growth and development programs. So as one is, again, using graphics to help display and promote an idea, we came up with this graphic for implementation. And what you see here is obviously specific in general, located on the side here, and then the development of process, showing that in the beginning, things were pretty specific in the issue identification. As you saw on the maps that we had created, specific land use, specific environmental features, specific census data, it is all very specific. But as you get into the vision and the goals and the objectives, you begin to move up, and as you write the text, it becomes much more general and conceptual in nature. Kind of wishy-washy, but it allows for that flexibility to promote creativity and development. And then as we come back down through implementation, we become more specific, because implementation measures need to be very specific in terms of creating a capital improvements program, updating your zoning so that you can implement the comprehensive specific recommendations, so you can take that general conceptual map and actually implement it. This is in Chicago. They collect information. You need that give and take and that feedback. As Bob talked, you went around to all the different communities within Porter County to get buy-off from the comprehensive plan. It's important to continue that intergovernmental cooperation so that zoning ordinances and subdivision control ordinances can be consistent, compatible, so that way when they're developed in the county and eventually annexed into a city, we have something that's consistent and compatible with what's already there. A strategic planning program. Some of the things that we looked at was there were lacking scenarios, including a capital improvements program. We talked about different ways that you come up with a CIP, different transportation recommendations. I mean, part of this plan that we didn't go over today was a whole comprehensive transportation section, as well as a parks master plan. Well, you need to begin to plan out the funds to, and how you're going to buy the parkland, what type of transportation improvements are you going to make. And you do that through a 5-year capital improvements program. So we talked about how that needs to be coordinated. Likewise, we talked about ongoing periodic review. While we talk about this document being a living document, an
It needs to be periodically reviewed. Why? Because changes, because conditions change. You know, right now the economy is slowing down. At the time we started this planning process, the county was booming. The things were going on. So how is this economic slowdown right now going to affect building permits and going to affect growth? So the plan needs to be able to anticipate that and be flexible with that. And finally, other policy recommendations. We developed a whole other series of lists of policy recommendations that the county needed time to take, to specific zoning ordinance recommendations, to different park sites that they needed to implement, and specific bike lanes and things like that they needed to purchase and develop. A whole list of, I don't know, it's probably a 40 or 50 items there, but all needs to be ranked and organized and again put into this workflow program. Again, coming back to the idea that once you create this vision, once you have the land use plan, and once it's set, you have a way to implement it. That really takes care of what the Board of County Comprehensive Land Use Plan, the federal draft one, is all about. And I just want to open it up for any questions that you might have.